In the past few years, there has been such an increased awareness of concussion, and we have a wonderful team in Sheltering Arms led by the fearless Cristin Beazley. And so hopefully you can learn something from us today. So everyone can hear me okay? So I have nothing to disclose. And so the objective of my lecture are to understand the definition of concussion and post-concussion syndrome, the etiology and pathophysiology, as well as the clinical presentation and evaluation of this disease, and also to understand my role as a physiatrist. And mind you, that's physiatrist, not psychiatrist. It's psychiatrist, so it's too close to psychiatrist. Right, Anthony? And also the current evidence that we have and the ongoing research. So there are many synonyms. The World Health Organization, the American Congress of Rehab Medicine, refers to this as mild TBI, and they shortened it to MTBI. The neurologists were the first ones who coined sports concussion, and the pediatricians, they call it mild closed-head injury. So this really all mean the same. So what happens in concussion? So it's a very complex pathophysiologic process that's induced by biomechanical forces, traumatic biomechanical forces, and it can be direct or indirect. So you do not have to have a direct blow to the head to suffer a concussion. So imagine the brain and the skull. The skull is a fixed space. It's a hard structure. So imagine Jell-O in a box and your brain moving in it. So if you can imagine that, that's what can happen when you have indirect forces acting on the brain. So what results are a constellation of physical, cognitive, emotional, and sleep-related symptoms. And you may not necessarily have loss of consciousness. And the duration of symptoms for some, it's just several minutes and they're good. For others, it can become chronic in years. And hopefully, we're hoping that with our help, we can prevent the disease from becoming chronic. Neuroimaging of the brain is not always done. It's not this, but if it is done, they're suspicious because there was some loss of consciousness or they're afraid there may be a bleed. So they do a CT scan, which is the standard imaging. And so this is your normal head CT scan. Okay, no swelling. The ventricles are nice. You can see the gray and white matter definition. What we don't want to see, and this is a true TBI, is this. You see the blood here. It's acute. It's an acute subdural hematoma. And you see there's so much swelling, you lose the white and gray matter definition. The brain is pushed to one side, and you see loss of the ventricles. You see only this. That's what we don't want to see. So in post-concussion syndrome, it's a collection of the symptoms that occur after a concussion. They set the arbitrary period as about 3 weeks based on research and Collins et al. We use two clinical criteria in general. You have the ICD-10, and I know all of you are familiar with ICD-10. It's been touted around so much since last year. And then the DSM-4. There's already a DSM-5. So this is a busy slide. I just want you to focus on the words highlighted in red. So you have to have a history of head trauma. We now have the very reliable and valid neuropsychological testing in Sheltering Arms. We use impact, among other things. And then you have all these symptoms that last at least 3 months. Sleep, fatigue, headache, vertigo or dizziness, mood changes, personality changes, and then this is enough to cause impairment in your social environment or your occupational functioning. And of course, it should not meet the criteria for dementia. For ICD-10, again, the history of traumatic brain injury, the presence of three or more of the following 8 symptoms, which I've listed. Again, headache, which is really the most common. But often you have patients with dizziness or vertigo, fatigue, irritability, insomnia, concentration and memory difficulties, as well as intolerance to stress and emotional changes. So based on CDC data,
The majority of traumatic brain injuries are actually mild traumatic brain injuries in 75 and in some literature as high as 85%. And the annual rate is 130 to 546 per 100,000 persons. So as an isolated injury or with other injuries, they found that about a lot, 1.7 million can suffer from concussions. And for sports specifically, 300,000 annually. So they did another study where they looked at sports and recreation, and it's very high, it's almost 4 million patients. So what is the impact? Unfortunately, some patients, about 200 plus thousand, it becomes chronic, and that's really unfortunate. So what is the public health cost? When I researched this 2 years ago, the data I found said 12 to 17 billion. So this is the latest cost that I found, 60 billion. So it's really come up. And is it a true increase? Maybe not. It could be because we're now more aware of concussion and there's treatment now for it. It does have a negative effect on psychological well-being and, of course, quality of life. Quality of life is affected. And in a higher family burden and emotional distress. So for age-specific considerations, 70.5% of emergency room visits related to traumatic brain injury are in the younger age group, 10 to 19 years old. That has a great impact because these are developing brains. Does anyone know when the frontal lobe matures? In your 30s, in your 30s, can you imagine that? So it explains the 20s. So anyway, what is important? They're still in school, you know, they still are planning their lives. So activity modification is key, and then academic accommodations. So we make these recommendations, and you know, we educate the patient, but we need the support of the parents because we're hoping that they follow through with all the recommendations. Also the guidance counselors in school. So the goal is to return them to previous level of activity, as with all rehab programs. It doesn't matter. Is it a stroke? Is it a spinal cord injury? Is it end-stage lung disease? We want to return them to their prior level of function as best we can. So with athletes especially, we take them through a progressive protocol called, we refer to it as the return to play protocol, and Christine will touch on this in detail. So we just want to make sure they are safely resuming their sports activities. So what happens in the brain? They refer to this as a neurometabolic cascade. So you have trauma. Good. You have trauma. And then what happens is the axons, everyone's familiar with axons, right? These are the nerve fibers that emanate from the brain cells or the neurons. There's overstretching, and actually, they've researched this, both in animals and post-mortem in human beings, and there is damage to the axons. It releases excitatory neurotransmitters. What are these? Serotonin, dopamine, glutamine. And then there is ionic shifts, where you have efflux of potassium and influx of calcium. It's calcium, actually, that enters the cells that cause the most damage. And then the membrane becomes very unstable. And you know, the brain, it's a highly, highly regulated organ. And so the neurons attempt to stabilize the membrane potential. And in this attempt, it demands more glucose, more energy. But over time, your mitochondria, which is the powerhouse of your cells, doesn't have enough to give. And over time, it decreases the metabolism, and you have this alteration of the tightly controlled metabolism. And in essence, you undergo an energy metabolic crisis, and there's a mismatch between demand and supply. So you hear this all the time in patients who have heart attacks. There's a supply-demand mismatch. So you're demanding that the heart work better, but there's no blood flow. What happens? You get the massive heart attack. So the brain is the same way. It's also regulated. So this results in the symptoms of post-concussion syndrome. Fortunately, the brain being what it is, undergoes a very dynamic restorative process over time. For some, it can take days, and of course, depending on the severity. For others, it can take a longer time. What's important is rest during the acute metabolic crisis. And that's really very intuitive, because when you're in crisis, you want to back off on demanding the brain to do cognitive tasks, and you want to avoid contact sports. So they did, there's always a question of, is it cumulative? And they did studies on, they did a lot of animal studies, much less, of course, on humans. It's harder to do it than humans. But they found out that, yes, there's damage to the axons. There's actually breakup, beading, and swelling of the axons, of these nerve fibers. And they also found out that there's a genetic basis. So if you carry the APOE4 allele, you're more vulnerable. So in boxers who carry this gene, and they studied also older versus younger athletes, those who carry this gene are more vulnerable, are more likely to develop chronic symptoms over time. This is from Laura, one of our therapists who found this. This is from UPMC in Pittsburgh, and they're now doing high definition fiber tracking. So it's just amazing. They're doing this now. And every type of fiber in the brain has a different color, and they're able to track it. Isn't that amazing? So you've all heard in the news about kids who go in after a hit and they die. You know, this is the second impact syndrome. It's rare. It's rare, but it's catastrophic. And the theory is that after sustaining a concussion, an initial concussion, the brain is very vulnerable to injury. So when another injury happens and you have unresolved metabolic dysfunction, which the brain is undergoing, it causes a congestion, this swelling in the brain. And when that swelling occurs due to marked breakdown of the blood-brain barrier, so there's loss of autoregulation. And mortality is high, it's up to 50%. Up to 50%, imagine that. I mean, it's very preventable. So it's mostly in children and adolescents, they're the most vulnerable. So for prognosis and recovery, current clinical experience and research, and again, this is intuitive, proper management, early intervention will lead to better prognosis. Those who return to contact sports before they recover have poorer prognosis. And so following them closely, which our team does through all the stages, will help them with better outcome. So, they used to think that maybe in 3 weeks there's full recovery. Nikki Collins out of Pittsburgh and his team, 80% they said recover within 21 days. The most recent, again, Christine pointed this out to me, and she's going to touch more on this, is that it's now longer, 3 to 4 weeks at least. But most group studies say that it typically resolves in 2 weeks. It doesn't hold anymore.
Is this for kids or all ages?
In general, yeah, in general. So what are the factors predicting recovery? Age, so adolescents, young kids are more vulnerable. When you do exertion before you recover, it delays your recovery. So getting back to sports, we often say you have to stop working, especially if it's highly stressful, and they, no matter what, they go back to work, they come back to your clinic, and they have all these symptoms, and it drags on until the day they decide they're going to back off and they feel better. Females report more post-concussion syndrome at 3 months than males. Those with a history of migraine, more severe post-concussion and your cognitive deficits. And again, I touched on this earlier, repetitive concussion, independently predicted long-term deficits. Those kids with ADHD and learning disability also have more prolonged recovery. The acute markers of traumatic brain injury, which is amnesia, it foreboded worse outcome and longer recovery than those who had some loss of consciousness or confusion, and persistent dizziness as well. And for subacute symptoms, after the acute phase, if they have persistent memory problems and fogginess, it takes longer for them to recover. Also, those with increased anxiety. So our approach is multidimensional. And so you take a really good history, you look at all the symptoms closely, look at the cognition. Physical therapy will usually do a very detailed balanced postural assessment. And of course, we take into consideration all the comorbidities, and the slide before you saw all the factors that then can affect recovery. So a good history and physical for physicians, it's already half of your diagnosis. So if you do a good history and P, you'll know. I use the post-concussion symptom scale, as do the therapist, and we track the recovery. We used to use it at every visit, but now we don't, because we find that sometimes it magnifies their symptoms when they see it all listed, and they say, yes, 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 when actually, doctor, I feel better. And it's all like severe, moderate. So I'll show it to you later. Then they do clinical testing and balance, the VOR and endurance. And then the most significant advancements are our neurocognitive testing. These are reliable and valid. Research is ongoing, and they use this data. And then it also tracks progress and recovery. We use impact in sheltering arms, but there are other neurocognitive tests. So this is the concussion grading scale. It goes through 22 symptoms, and we score it. And the key is, we tell patients, it's not what you felt the last 2 weeks, it's what you feel at the moment, at the very moment when you're here in the clinic. So it just gives us an idea about the severity of their symptoms. Then we score it, do the total out of 132. So the higher the score, the more symptomatic and severe it is. So the post-concussion symptom scale looks at four clusters of symptoms. So you have somatic symptoms, your headache, dizziness, balance issues, nausea, phonophobia, photophobia, low energy and blurred vision. We look at sleep dysfunction. They have either trouble falling asleep, or they're sleeping the whole day, they're sleeping too much, or they go to sleep, but then they keep waking up 5 times and it's not restorative. They're drowsy and tired the next day. Then you have cognitive symptoms. So patients complain it's foggy. They're tired after just reading for 1 minute when they used to be avid readers. They can't concentrate, they can't remember. The miss words. And then you have mood disruption. They're more anxious. Sometimes they come in, they don't know why they're crying. They just start bawling, and they don't know why. They're very emotionally labeled. And some become very frustrated about their condition. You know. So impact looks at, it's a computer-based cognitive test, and we look at four composite scores: visual memory, verbal memory, reaction time, and processing speed. And if you do a baseline, which is ideal, then you can track their recovery throughout time. Now, the approach to treatment is individualized. So there are standardized concussion grading scales, but in the end, it's individualized. But these scales have helped us, this testing has helped us focus more on the problems of the individual. And the cornerstones of treatment are education, 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 as well as cognitive or brain rest and physical rest. And this isn't, physical rest is relative. It doesn't mean you won't do anything and lay down the whole day, but you'll do activities that won't trigger your symptoms. So we prefer that they do as much as they can. So our approach is interdisciplinary. We have the physical therapist, medical psychologists, and you'll hear from them shortly. We every so often we have the speech therapists involved, those with a lot of cognitive issues. And in medical management, there is no magic pill. You don't go through sheltering arms and we have a magic door. But what we do is we have medications that we can use. A lot of it is off-label, but they're being researched and they're effective. They help the patient. So I always believe in starting at the low dose and slowly increasing the dose. I'm very conservative. And there's ongoing research. And then as a team, we meet every week and discuss the patients, which is, I think, one of the strengths of our team. So for somatic symptoms, Post-traumatic headache is the most common, 85% of patients. Now, it's considered a secondary type of headache. So some patients are born with headaches, so that's the primary. So you have either cervicogenic, so when a lot those who have whiplash, a lot of spasm and neck pain, or they have existing arthritis and then they develop the whiplash, and so it worsens their symptoms. You have fatigue-related headaches, you have tension or myofascial pain. When there is a strong impact at the back of the head, you can injure the greater occipital nerve. You can have post-traumatic migraine, and that's unfortunate for some. They develop really bad migraines. And you can have rebound headaches, actually, from medications that doctors give. So for tension and myofascial headaches, we use NSAIDs sparingly and muscle relaxants, especially those that are non-sedating. We do trigger point injections for those that require greater occipital nerve blocks. We do that. For physical therapy, they do manual therapy. They do modalities, heat or ice, stretching, myofascial release. They do taping. We've started referring our patients also for dry needling. Acupuncture, I believe in a holistic approach. I think the use of acupuncture, biofeedback, relaxation techniques is essential. Unfortunately, a lot of these are out of pocket. So how do we prevent or treat the headaches? If you're, this amitriptyline is the most studied. So we use other SSRIs like Celexa, Zoloft, and Effexor. The nice thing about amitriptyline, if you're worried about a patient who has problems sleeping, the side effect is lethargy and drowsiness. So you can give it at night, helps with the headache, and helps with sleep. Those who develop migraine, we give them abortive medication. So when they feel the migraine coming on, we give them the triptans. So these are the most popularly used, sumatriptan or Imitrex, and then mock salt. It can come in oral, inhaled, or injectable form. There was a patch that they pulled off the market because it caused skin burns. And then we have anticonvulsants. The most that I use is gabapentin. I have a few patients on valproic acid and topamax. So anticonvulsants actually stabilize the brain electrical activity. Beta blockers are used for Panadol, but you just have to watch the heart rate and blood pressure. Not everyone can tolerate this. And if the migraine becomes more chronic, I have a few patients where I do botulinum toxin injections, which is FDA approved for migraine treatment. Rebound headache can be caused by medications, usually. So patients, they go to the ER, they're given 600, 800 milligrams of ibuprofen TID, they're given Fioricet, which is the favorite, Fioricet. But these medications can cause rebound headache, especially when you stop them. So I've had to wean patients off. I can't even imagine weaning patients off anti-inflammatories like Advil, but I do wean them off. Because when you stop abruptly, they often report the worst migraine they've ever had. So weaning them off has been very, it's easy to do, but it's effective. And opiates, there's really no place for narcotic pain medications in concussion. And this surprised me that Tylenol, greater risk of rebound headache than NSAIDs and triptans. So they're taking Tylenol 4 times a day. And suddenly another physician gives them medication, they stop the Tylenol, and then they get a rebound headache. So that's one of the medications implicated. So they researched in primary headache brain vitamins. I refer to them as concussion supplements. And they found out in primary headache that it can decrease the severity and frequency of headache. So they translated this into secondary headache, and they tried it, and they found it helped. So these are over-the-counter, and they help patients. Then let's look at magnesium. What is the role of magnesium? It stabilizes the cell membrane, so the axons and the neurons. It's important for the generation of ATP, which is the sole source of energy of each cell actually in the body. So that's just magnesium. So I usually give them 3 supplements over the counter, and I stop it over time as they improve. The next most common is dizziness. As many as 80% of patients report this, and this is a dysfunction of your vestibular system. So they found out that dizziness is an independent risk factor for failure to return to work. So it's really important to treat this. And it correlates with other post-concussive symptoms. You know, all the post-concussion clusters, the four clusters I showed you, they interact. So if you didn't sleep well, your headache can get worse, or you're in a worse mood. So they interact. So it correlates with other post-concussion symptoms. Post-traumatic headache may contribute to dizziness. You can have a complex kind of headache. And you manage the headache, and of course, vestibular therapy is important. Those with anxiety, especially, they become very anxious with vertigo, and they have such fear of falling. Because of this, they become very anxious. So we treat it with anxiolytics. I prefer the SSRIs, like Effexor and all that, because Xanax, Valium, it's sedating, and it can be habit-forming, and it's hard to wean off, especially Valium. And again, vestibular rehab and more research, of course, is needed. So the two types of dizziness are peripheral and central vestibulopathy. So peripheral, you have crystals in the ear because of the impact that can get dislodged and could cause vertigo. So you have these crystals that are floating in the ear where they shouldn't be floating. So the therapists do certain maneuvers to diagnose which canal in the ear. We have three semicircular canals, which ear it's floating in, and then they do a corrective maneuver to reposition the crystal. It's usually very dramatic if you have it. And then you have central vestibulopathy. The vestibular system is so complex. It's from the top of your head to the tip of your toes. Everything is interconnected. Every joint, every nerve, every muscle, every tendon. And it's a complex circuit in the brain. So vestibular therapy is the mainstay. What medications do we use? Antiemetics. If they're very symptomatic in the beginning, please give them some comfort and relieve their nausea and vomiting. So Zofran and Reglan are the most used. With caution, we use vestibular suppressants. They often like to give Dramamine, Meclizine. Some doctors like to give scopolamine patches, or benzodiazepines. The problem with these vestibular suppressants, it's okay to give it very short term, but if you give it too long, your brain is not gonna learn. It's not gonna learn to overcome the vertigo, the dizziness. It's not gonna learn what the therapists are doing to train your brain to compensate, to habituate, because it suppresses that ability.
I'll just jump in real quick with Dr. Littaua. With the meclizine from a PT perspective, I know some PTs in here are quite good. We rarely use meclizine. If they come to us on meclizine, we try to get them off of it. I think in all of the cases we've seen, I've maybe asked Dr. Littaua to actually prescribe something twice because I could not get the patient to tolerate any therapy, so I couldn't progress them. And then as soon as they did better therapy, we got them off of it right away. So they really are used very sparingly for the dizziness. It's usually in more extreme cases that we.
Thank you, Christine. So sleep dysfunction, many causes can be the mood disorder, environmental, music, phone, electronics are a big culprit. They emit blue light. And the patients like to go to bed with their phones or their iPads, and it actually affects sleep. We'll talk about that later. Neurophysiological actual injury to the, I discussed this earlier, the axons that get overstretched, pain, some pharmacologic effects. Some medications are actually stimulating, so you don't give them at night. And if they have a history of sleep disorder, that presents more of a challenge. And of course, patients who have PTSD. PTSD, I've encountered a few, not common, but they have PTSD-like symptoms, and it does affect sleep. So what are the adverse effects of dysonia? So you have decreased quality of life, increased accidents. We tell patients who don't sleep, who are dizzy, please do not drive. Please do not handle sharp objects. But you know, there's increased risk of accidents. There's increased rate of chronic pain. They have more difficulty concentrating. They're more anxious and depressed. And it's an independent risk factor for poor physical and mental health overall. So what's the treatment? You have both non-pharmacologic and pharmacologic treatment. So for non-pharmacologic treatment, proper sleep hygiene, we cannot emphasize this enough. Turn off the TV, turn off your iPhone, especially an hour before you settle down for sleep, because this actually suppresses melatonin that helps you sleep. It also is very stimulating the blue light. So avoid caffeine. If they can't absolutely live without caffeine, I tell them, please don't drink caffeine beyond 11 o'clock. And watch what you drink. Coke has caffeine, Pepsi has caffeine, tea has caffeine. There are hidden, there are drinks there with hidden amounts of coffee. Alcohol, especially in small amounts, is stimulating. Cigarettes. Consistent bedtime. You tell them at the same time, you know. Try to sleep and wake up at the same time. And some of them can't help it. They're going to nap. So we make, we kind of compromise. One power nap after lunch for 30 minutes, that's it. Because some of them sleep for like 3-4 hours and then they can't sleep at night. So relaxation therapy, and I really like it when the psychologist gives them relaxation tapes. It helps them. Now they're, for the past few years, they've researched the effect of light. So they call this light therapy. So it affects melatonin production. Bright light suppresses it. Darkness encourages melatonin production. And melatonin is produced by the brain so that you can sleep. So it improves or modifies abnormalities in our wake, sleep-wake cycles. So they found out, and they did these studies in PTSD patients, and they've done a lot of collaborative. If you're interested, trials.gov, they have a lot of research there. And they also, the sleep societies have done it, and among other many groups. So they found out that bright light or blue light therapy reduced daytime sleepiness. Blue light's emitted by the sun. It's emitted by all these bright lights, by your electronics. That's blue light. It improved mood and performance, and particularly they looked at attention, information processing, memory, and executive function. The red spectrum, so this is at the lower end of your visible light. It's the lowest energy of your visible light. It's very slow moving. So actually your brain perceives it as darkness. So it tricks the brain into producing more melatonin. It encourages relaxation and calmness because it's perceived as no light or a little presence of light. So some of my patients, I tell them, you know, those small red lights, just plug it into your dark bedroom and it's going to help. Pharmacologic treatment, melatonin, we use a lot. It's over the counter. I think it's very helpful. Some have low levels of melatonin. Sometimes it comes with an amino acid. What is that? L-threonine, Anthony? Mm-hmm. And then you have antidepressants, amitriptyline and trazodone, that help with sleep. Non-benzohypnotics, but only for the short term, you have Sonata. I don't like using Ambien. I find that Ambien, there are a lot of patients who develop side effects. And you know, you look at the research now, it's not, the side effects are significant. Sonata is good because it's very short acting, very, very short acting. I use also antihistamines like Vistaril. I don't use Benadryl, especially in the elderly, because of the side effects. And then I use again Xanax, Ativan, which are benzodiazepines, with great, great caution. So for cognitive symptoms, again, the neurocognitive testing are reliable and valid. In moderate to severe traumatic brain injury, cognitive deficits improve with neurostimulants, and I'm going to show you later. In post-concussion syndrome, research is ongoing. There's still no good randomized controlled trials. A lot of anecdotal reports, but all these medications are more widely used. I, as a physician, and my partner have seen it help patients. So we use amantadine, which is a dopamine agonist, methylphenidate, atomoxetine, and modafinil. If patients have persistent symptoms, we send them to the speech therapist for cognitive remediation. And then mood disruption. So patients are very frustrated, they're anxious, they feel isolated, especially when you pull them out of work, out of their favorite sports, and kids out of school. They get so anxious and stressed, like they're falling behind, they feel isolated, but it's necessary for their recovery. But we try to return them back as soon as we can. It worsens their perception of cognitive impairment and pain, so it can magnify their symptoms. And it interferes with recovery. And in particular, PTSD is something I want to talk about. Very cautious in diagnosing this. And it's uncommon, actually, after a car accident or there's delayed symptom onset, you have to be careful. And those with a psychiatry history, memory of the event, or who develop major symptoms at a higher risk. DSM-5 has a criteria, so you have patients who have nightmares, who have an excessive startle response, who they see something and it stimulates the traumatic event. I had a patient who heard a car crash in front of her and just went into this meltdown. So the medical psychologist is very helpful in our team. We also refer to a psychiatrist. We use medications like SSRIs and tricyclic antidepressants. Again, there are no randomized controlled trials in concussion treatment. Caution in adults and adolescents because of the increase in suicide risk. More recently, the advances in psychopharmacology and the treatment of PTSD, they found out a combination of these two medications, and I use this, omeprazolin and trazodone, has decreased nightmares and decreased symptoms of PTSD. So in summary, these are very disabling conditions, not only in the athletes, but in the general population, young and old. Neurocognitive testing has improved diagnosis. Our approach, and as each approach should be individualized. And in Sheltering Arms, we have an interdisciplinary team approach. And hopefully, more and more research will be done to help our patients. Thank you.
Okay, so today I'm breaking my thing into about three parts here. Return to work, return to learn, and then some differential stuff, which Dr. Littaua already did address some of those things, and I know that Cristin is going to as well. So there will be subtle differences. A lot of it you'll see will overlap, and I'll take, you know, if there's any questions at the end of mine, I'll try to take one or two, but then try to get Cristin up here to see if at the end of hers, then maybe all three of us could answer questions. Cristin and I usually have good discussions, particularly when we don't agree on something, but everybody learns a lot more as a result. So one other thing is I'm going to spend more time on return to work than return to learn, just because of some of the people that I saw that were coming today. But I did include all the slides for return to learn so that you'd have that if I didn't address that adequately. And there is a Virginia Department of Education protocol for return to learn, and nothing's perfect, but at least there is something in existence to go by, whereas with return to work, there's, you know, we're often shooting from the hip. So one of the primary things to first note in return to work is that the best predictor for return to work following a brain injury of all severity levels is the job stability 6 months prior to the injury. There's been a lot of other studies that have shown this with other injuries as well, and job stability has been kind of a capture of other terms like, you know, interpersonal relationships with coworkers and particularly supervisor. So this does have everything to do with returning to work. The individual is going through all this stuff. They're trying to understand it. They have Cristin, Dr. Littaua, myself trying to explain things to them, and then they have to try to explain that to somebody else when their wits aren't about them. So if you have someone who's just like, it's okay, we trust you, you'll get back when you can, versus why aren't you here, that makes all the difference in the world. So that's an important thing to note, also because when you see individuals that are out of work because of a concussion and it's a year or two later, you're not treating the concussion anymore, you're treating everything that happened after that too. You kind of acquire other things on the way with a snowball. Again, this is true for those even with more severe injuries. So, if I see an individual after after they had a concussion, ideally the sooner the better. The first thing that we need to do is educate them and give them expectations of what the recovery is going to look like, what some recovery windows are, what variability there is, and what factors could lead to variability. So if you do have, if you had a concussion before and you were better in 3 days, and now it's 3 weeks, you don't feel like your brain's falling apart, but you know that there might be other factors about this concussion that's making that last a little bit longer. This doesn't always happen, but ideally it does, and they've been researched, God bless you, they've been researching this for over 30 years and have found this to be true. Mittenberg came up with a study, I believe, in the late 80s or early 90s that showed expectations and education right after. So ER docs, you would think after 30 years now, would all have a perfect protocol for what to tell a patient after they had a concussion. And of course, that's not happening. So once we get all the education stuff out of the way, which oftentimes alleviates some symptoms on its own, because you eliminate the fear factor, and fear can generate some of these symptoms by itself. Then we look at proactive rest. So again, this is more important early on, but it could be important 3 months later if the person's never done it. They feel good, they go, they run out of gas, and it feels like they have a concussion again the next day. So proactive rest is taking rest before you feel like you need it. It's using an external device to guide your rest, not your internal device of, gee, I'm tired, I should sit down. It's using something like a timer to say, if after 30 minutes I start to feel that pressure in my head build up, I need to stop at around 26 minutes, 28 minutes, somewhere in there. 80, 85, 90% at the most, but that's your proactive rest. There's an increase that will go with this, and another way of understanding proactive rest is looking at your circadian rhythms. All of us have highs and lows in our arousal throughout the day. We're going to have peaks of attention and we're going to have little dips. So by doing proactive rest and kind of logging what's going on with you, you could find where those best times of the day are for you. And when you're recovering from a concussion, during your dips, you actually need to take a more specific, structured break. So the next thing we do is, one other note is screen time. So I may say that you could do work or school work or whatever type of work you're doing at your job for 45 minutes, but I may say only 15 minutes of screen time, or even 5 minutes for some people. That's where their threshold is. Some exposure, though, as soon as like a week after, some exposure is actually good for the individual to get those brain areas working again, but you just have to kind of, gas and brake, gas and brake. Coping skills training, there's just multiple rationale for why and when I do this, but one of the simplest things to start with is that a lot of people don't know how to rest, especially people who get better from other injuries because they're workers and they go after it and they'll do whatever the physical therapist tells them to do for homework. With a concussion, you can't just do an extra set to get better. On the contrary, again, you have to take that break before you feel like you need it. So if you say to someone you need to sit down for 15 minutes in between after an hour of work, you're creating an anxiety disorder by making them sit there. So what are you going to do for those 15 minutes is where the coping skills training comes in. So I start with stuff like diaphragmatic breathing and mindful breathing and mindfulness meditations, and they have like 5 minute mindfulness apps now too that have been really helpful for me. So what to do when you're resting, again, some people are not good at it. But here's some other more sophisticated, I had a patient who did really well with this, and this also overlaps nicely with so much of the cervicogenic symptoms that come from a concussion or that are often associated with that same injury. If you could learn how to kind of shut your muscles off, that's going to also reduce your headache, it's going to reduce your anxiety level, and kind of subsequently improve your focus. Okay, so again, typical protocol, if there is a such thing, I build up the time for that activity rest model. You take rest out, or you shorten the duration of rest when an individual has demonstrated that they can handle it. When people do this and they actually go home and start doing this, they get better faster. I don't have any controlled research to demonstrate that, but it's pretty simple to see. Often it's they get better faster than I even expected them to, just by going home and doing this. So you do have to be compliant with it, and I often try to help. I often try to have people commit to like maybe 3 days, because if you say you have to do this, and they're like, I can't do that forever, but it's like, can you do it for 3 days? And then if it works, then they're going to keep doing it thereafter. So then we increase duties and complexity and responsibility. So complexity, of course, we're dealing with more higher level thinking here. It could be multitasking or anything involving higher level reasoning. So if you're not an accountant and you're home figuring out your bills, that's a complex task. But then the responsibility factor here too is, depending on what kind of job you do, the level of responsibility that you have. Even if you're not an anxious person, you have just a general level of arousal that raises a little bit. And that's fine, that's what helps us focus. But during this time, too much of that kind of burns us out really quickly, and then we start chasing our tail. We work harder because we're tired, and this becomes an anxiety condition. So just management of basic duties working into complexity, this gradually increases, and this gradually increases. Sometimes when I meet with someone, I have to lay all this out because I don't have another opening for 2 or 3 weeks. And I could tell that they're really recovering on a nice slope here. And I say, somewhere between 3 and 7 days, you're going to do this. Somewhere between 7 and 14 days, you're going to do this. And, you know, less is more. When they kind of can start this early on, it just takes off from there. And then after that, I don't know what the perfect model is. At 3 weeks, if you do everything you're supposed to do at 1 and 2, you don't need to probably see me at 3. So compensatory strategy training. So those of you that are familiar with working with individuals with brain injury, probably more moderate to severe level brain injury, know that there's a lot of different compensatory strategies, and some of those that are most basic are most effective. Some things are notebooks, to-do lists, calendars, smartphone apps, etc. These are, again, there's multiple rationale. They're twofold, they're fourfold, they're 27-fold. So if you can get a to-do list down, that often helps patients stop ruminating and worrying. So now it's an anxiety treatment, because you get it out of here and you put it down here. When you're holding all that stuff in your head, you're exhausting your working memory. So just by having an anxiety condition, you're also exhausting some of your cognitive skills. So these things constantly overlap. And I see all the time where patients are doing stuff and they can't, and then they find their keys are in the cabinet and everything else, and we've all had days like that probably, but it's like, what were you thinking about that? At that moment, they're having a conversation with their boss of why they're still out of work, but it's all up here. They're doing their job from home, so they're picturing themselves, I don't know how I'm going to go back to work, you understand, I have to do this, I have to do this. It's like, I'm not telling you to go back today, so stop thinking about it today. And that's easier said than done. So that's where these lists come in. I tell patients, write to me about everything I'm wrong about. So if you're home talking to me in your head, write it down. We can discuss it when you get in. But it gets out of your head, and it helps them actually relax. And then, of course, for the reason that a lot of us do to-do lists anyway, it helps you organize your tasks. It helps you start to prioritize your tasks. It builds into time management. Good old-fashioned to-do list. So, if you're out, you have a complex concussion, and when I say that's not a diagnostic term. They've used complex MTBI to when there's actually imaging that shows up on an MRI or a CAT scan. But complex, I mean that you're going to PT for vestibular, you're going to PT for ocular motor, and you're going to PT for cervical stuff. So you got it all going on. And sometimes, you know, you could only kind of work on one area at a time. Sometimes your body, you can only heal, you know, one thing. And certainly there's overlap in healing, but these things take longer. And sometimes they haven't been addressed. It's not uncommon for us to get a patient, again, 3 months, 6 months, or 2 years later, that's never had their neck addressed, and they're walking around with these, you know, concussion symptoms. So when you're out of work for that long, sometimes the best thing to do to go back to reduce the anxiety and also build on that gradual increase of tasks is just treat them like a new employee. So do you have any training manuals at home? Because all of us keep those, right? So you might have to go back into your HR and ask for one. But if you have any notes, if I ask them to approach it like you were training someone else to do your job, again, not all up here, but writing down what are the steps you need to do. And a lot of externalizing of the frontal lobe functioning, not because your frontal lobe's damaged, but because it's tired. Because after a concussion, all these systems are exhausted. So the work with the HR part, that's more specific. I know there's a handful of clinicians in here, but there's no easy way to do this. All HRs are different. I could come up with the perfect plan of how an individual should re-enter into their work, and then they have a rule like you can't come back until you're 100%. So there's going to be some correspondence between you and HR. You write out this perfect plan, and then they send you a 30-page package you have to fill it anyway. So I just wanted to put that in here so that you know that if you're going to be a clinician taking on this population and trying to help them get back into the workforce, these are things that you want to plan for up front so you could have a policy already in place. You could ask the person right when they get there, does your HR, do you have any paperwork that I need to fill out? Because please don't give it to me in the last 5 minutes of our session. Yeah, so this correspondence, and this gets tricky. You don't want to write too much. I'm a clinical psychologist, so we have confidentiality and confidentiality, and then confidentiality, we don't even talk about it, has another word, nobody knows it. So how do you explain to the work what's going on with this individual when you can't really explain anything? So, you know, use some generic terms. I do purposely use jargon, and I just kind of give, they love deadlines, they love dates. And I hate dates because so much of what we do relies on the monitoring of progress, but I try to write it equivocally to some extent, but I do write dates now. It's going to be individualized again. Sometimes there's so much anxiety going on with an individual that, you know, a lot of people are not going to see. I don't care if you've been a psychologist for 20 years. You don't always, you've seen your patients that have a lot of somatic conditions, but some very high functioning people that just kind of wear anxiety differently really carry these symptoms with them longer. And sometimes just getting into work that one day for exposure therapy, for those familiar with behaviorism, your symptoms are gone. They're there, they're rolling in it, and they're good. So this is always going to be individualized too. And they, you know, if it's necessary, they can observe or shadow. I've done this with teachers more often because when you're a teacher, there's no gradual. It's like you're only allowed to raise your hand like 3 times today, yeah, right? So once you're there, you're on, you know? So I've had them sit in classroom just to get used to the lights, get used to the students' voices and everything else like that. And sometimes we have to reinvent the wheel. So if you have, I just try to help. I do a functional analysis of everything. I ask them why, what's difficult. Don't tell me you can't remember. What can't you remember? Memory reported is typically an attention problem. Because memory, a real memory problem, you don't remember that you have it. So there's different ways of trying to analyze, without even doing any formal testing, where errors are occurring in a person's day. And that's where you start with their treatment plan. And with regard to returning to work, you have to do the same thing. What parts of your work are you going to have difficulty with? What parts might I see as barriers? and you try to recreate those environments. So if they're in a typical office environment, anything from a library to Barnes & Noble or Starbucks, to have people and voices and noises and lights around while you're focusing on some work. Okay, so now I'm shifting gears. That's my return to work stuff, and I can't answer questions about that if you have any at the end of this. But so trajectories and differential diagnosis. I want to talk about why this is so important. When you have a multidisciplinary team, you're going to do a lot better with this anyway, because we're all going to use different tools and come from a different school of thought in examining our patients. And then we're going to talk about it, and we're going to see things differently, and hopefully that means we don't miss as much. But all too often, you know, you have one physician examining the person, and you have a blanket statement like you're out of work for a month until you feel better. It's a week. If you're still not better after a week, then it's a month. There's just different ways to go about that. So looking at all the other factors that are going on, so differential diagnosis is part of anything, but right now in concussions especially, they were so underreported for so long. We're doing so much to raise awareness about it. I started working as a cognitive rehab specialist in 2004. I had to tell people like what a brain injury was so that we can kind of facilitate more communication about the program I was working with. In 2005, the USA Today called the mild TBI the signature wound of the Iraq conflict. In 2008, somewhere in there, the NFL lawsuit started. So momentum has been building from other types of things, not just people walking around in education with pamphlets, but media attention. It also means that the information out there is not always accurate. If you took any one thin slice of Dr. Littaua's presentation without hearing her kind of talk all the way through it, you could really distort it. And this does happen sometimes. So now, as we have this kind of, what if it's a concussion? Oh no. Sometimes we forget that most people are getting better and don't even need a lot of medical attention. It only takes 10 to 20% to keep us very busy, but this still is, it's a treatable thing, and when it's correctly identified, it's not catastrophic. So I've seen and heard a lot of patients come in diagnosed with concussion, and they just have an abnormal symptom history. And onset of symptoms sometimes as much as a week after, but if you're a 16-year-old male and you play football or you play soccer and you go to your doctor and you're having headaches, did you hurt your head at practice? Yeah, you probably have a concussion. So they come in, and I've had kids with sinus infections, I've had kids with mono, I've had kids with a lot of kids, because I think that it's kind of a better have a false positive than a false negative thought, which I don't know if that's even true all the time. If you're talking about returning them to play, then it is. But if you're talking about returning them to school, I think that you should probably rule out a couple other things before you call it a concussion right away. And I've seen it in adults as well. So the post-concussion symptom checklist, there's several of them out there. Most of them have the same symptoms on there, and they use a grading scale from 0 to 6. There's been multiple studies that in the last 10 years that show that it does not correlate with concussion. So if everyone in this room filled one out, some of us may have had a concussion last week, some of us may have had one last year or 10 years ago, and some of us may have never had one. And there'd be no relationship between the symptoms endorsed on that sheet and the actual existence of a concussion or not. So if the concussion has already been identified, and the physician wants to use this to monitor some of the common symptoms that are going on, that's what it was developed for, not to diagnose concussion. But you see it often where, you know, the patient's score is reported and they say, well, gee, you must have post-concussive syndrome. And, you know, he saw the same thing with ADD. years back, and you see it with other diagnoses when they're, you know, nobody wants to walk around and say, hey, I have depression. But if you look at the symptoms on depression checklist, most of us have had those, but it's not as glamorized as concussion is right now, because concussion happens to football players and soldiers, so it's an okay thing to have right now. And it's dangerous. So Iverson looked at 31,000 high school students, but no history of concussion within the year of this study. So that day or a whole year before that. They had them fill out some symptom checklists. And this went a little further. It had the symptom burden. So this is like more getting more specifically diagnosis. How do these symptoms prevent you from going about your day? 19% of boys and 28% of girls reported symptoms that basically would meet criteria for ICD-10 diagnosis of post-concussive syndrome with no injury. So this is not a specific tool. So we have to rely on a lot of stuff when we're asking our patients if they get better. When you do see persistent symptoms, if they have not seen a specialist, then they need to see a specialist. If they've seen a specialist and they still have persistent symptoms, you need to also start rolling out other things. In neuropsychology, we get these cases all the time. And unfortunately, a lot of school of thought in neuropsych is that there's no organic brain injury, then it's depression or it's anxiety, because there's certainly a lot of studies that show that this symptom checklist do have higher numbers in individuals with depression and anxiety. But there's like 100 other things too, or 1,000, that can cause some of these symptoms. And I've seen all the time on neuropsych reports, you know, no evidence of this, the symptom onset was different, it's depression. And the individual's like, but I'm not depressed. So what's that individual know? Nothing. They have no idea where these symptoms are coming from, and then now people are making them feel like they're crazy. So some common ones are major depressive anxiety disorder. Fibromyalgia and chronic pain have higher scores on this than people with concussions, even in their first and second week. The problem is that, again, attribution, depending on how you look at the injury, where I said it can be glamorized, it's also scary. So you see the concussion movie, you hear about chronic traumatic encephalopathy, you hear about some of these things, and if you think that your headaches are coming from a concussion that occurred 3 years ago, that means your headaches are coming from brain damage. Well, individuals with brain damage don't have the headaches necessarily because you don't have nerve endings in your brain. So if you have a big tumor in there, you probably still won't even feel it. So the problem is that there's other things going on, and while your brain probably had some level of damage or injury occurred with that concussion, that's probably long been resolved. Our brains are incredibly resilient and they do get better. But you have something causing you pain, we need to figure out what it is. Because it will get worse with your stress and anxiety about it. So some common differentials to be ruled out with persistent cognitive dysfunction, again, this is where a lot of the referrals that I get come from, could often be missed or overlooked when everybody just keeps attributing this to concussion. Chris and I were talking about yesterday that there's, you know, some variability in information on how long the brain actually takes to recover. What imaging studies show, do they even correlate with symptoms and this and that. But the cognitive areas in our brain, the areas that are most active during certain cognitive functions, there's no studies that have shown that they are actually injured by a concussion. There's diffuse axonal shearing or stretching, as Dr. Littaua noted with the axons, and they carry the information everywhere. So anything can be slowed down, particularly early on. But when someone's not remembering stuff and having gaps of amnesia, months after their concussion, you can be pretty sure that it's not the concussion. Either someone missed a more severe injury, or there's something else going on. So I think I mentioned earlier about the allergy sinus infection. This is a common one with colds, or a common one with headaches. And this can happen, you know, these kids are in school, or all of us around certain times of year, there's just a natural influx. So you had a concussion, and it started to get better, and then it started to get worse. You know, especially if you did, if you're in a car accident, you did hit your face, and you have some sinus inflammation, and then you have history, like you can't tell by my voice, of sinus problems. So you have a weak spot there, and that could really cause havoc a lot longer. The difference is, I'm not scared to death if I have a horrible headache. I don't think I'm going to die of my brain exploding, because I know that it's a lot of things, but probably not my concussions. So that's where the differential diagnosis and education of the patient is so important. So yes, I am saying that, yeah, we need to raise awareness, and at the same time, we need to know when to look for other things, too. We can't just keep saying it's all related to the concussion. Here's a list of some other differentials. This was an article, Is It Really a Concussion? And basically, they're just showing that there's so much overlap between concussion and cervical injuries that they both they present with the same symptoms, and they can present with persistent symptoms. And a lot of the tests that, this is one of the leading researchers in concussion and sports medicine, Kristen and Dr. Littaua, both very familiar with him. He has found that most of his tests don't work to differentiate the two, but the treatment, which ones they respond to, are going to help differentiate. So I talk about that here, I talked about the expectation. Basically, the placebo effect that we've all heard of, if you expect to get better, you're going to get better. If you expect to feel worse, you're going to feel worse. So when you have movies and commercials and all this other stuff saying about how bad a concussion is and you get diagnosed with one, you're more likely to have persistent symptoms based solely on expectation. Which now education is that much harder, because I'm not just telling somebody what's going on, I'm retelling them and trying to convince them. The longer out you are from the injury, the harder that can be sometimes, because they feel like I'm telling them they're crazy. It's like, no, there's an explanation for everything you're feeling, but it's just not this. And last but not least, Jim McMahon, who many of you probably know, quarterback for the Chicago Bears 1985 Super Bowl, he was CTE's poster boy. A couple years ago they had him on, ESPN did a study. He could barely talk, he wasn't putting sentences together, they called it early onset dementia. And you saw his picture blasted everywhere as evidence that football and repeated concussion injuries causes dementia. And most recently, and this guy spent millions and millions of dollars on treatments, which is also part of this expectation stuff, because if the doctor says, oh yeah, I can help you with that, but it's going to take this long, well, he has a big pocket, so it's going to take a long time. Then he went and found a doctor that looked at his spine a different way, and it's a standing MRI, and they found that his first two cervicals, C1 and C2, which are your axis and your atlas, were disrupted, and they did an adjustment to his cervical, and his symptoms went away like that. 10 years later, after being on opiate medications, after being on all kinds of anticonvulsants and everything else that they treat migraines with when they don't go away, and when the guy couldn't put sentences together, is it because he's not sleeping? Is it because he's depressed? Is it because he's on all these medications? He also did have a blockage, according to this study anyway, of cerebral spinal fluid, so there was some brain damage possibly occurring. But it wasn't just from multiple concussions, it was because this thing here was never treated. So you need to keep looking. When symptoms don't go away, you don't just call it dementia when the guy's only 50 years old. So now he's going to do a new, there's going to be another ESPN coming up pretty soon here, and he's going to talk about cervical stuff now, and now he doesn't have CTE anymore. So the return to learn stuff is on there for your review, and I'm going to get done here so Kristen can come on up.
Me last because I talk the fastest, so I keep you guys awake, and they give me the least amount of time. But actually today they gave me the most amount of time, which was nice. I always like to know who I'm talking to. So who here works with adults? Who here works with kids? Okay, a little bit. Who here is workers' comp? That's always my good one. Okay. So I'm going to kind of try to pull all this information together for you. You're not going to walk out of here saying, I know exactly how to treat a concussion, I know exactly what it's going to look like. But the key is, how do we manage the injury? So the injury itself is very treatable. What I think has not been mentioned quite yet is that, is it ever just a concussion? Anthony talked a lot about kind of things we need to be differentially diagnosing, looking at different aspects. Dr. Littaua talked about some different things. I think the one thing that's lost is it may not necessarily be the concussion that's causing some of the symptoms, but it's still the mechanism of injury. So for my workers' comp folks, that's really still important, because it may not be necessarily the concussion that's causing some of the symptoms, but it still results from a direct result of that mechanism of injury that caused perhaps a concussion, as well as some cervical spine dysfunction, perhaps some BPPV, and all of those things. So that needs to be managed at the same time. The way our program works, it's a little bit different in kind of when we manage certain populations. So our kids, it's a little bit different versus maybe how we manage some of our more complex adults, how we manage our workers' comps. For my workers' comps folks, I would say we have had the most success in our program when all three services are managed. I often tell my providers who work with workers' comp patients, if you're gonna send them for PT, better please check PM&R and medical psychology, because we're gonna use all three services, because it really helps with that global management of the diagnosis and returning these people back to work successfully. Not every one of my teenagers that walks in that's a typical sports-related concussion, I'm gonna use the other services. It just depends on what the presentation is, but because of the complications with workers' comp, returning to work, some of the other factors, it's really important that we use all three services. And I'm gonna get on my soapbox really quickly. Earlier, the better. So that's the one thing that, you know, really hasn't been hit. The earlier we see these patients, the better, because we get the education out there. We tell them what the expectations is. We tell them we can manage that. And it decreases a lot of that anxiety and fear around that injury. And then we can manage them, return them to what they need to be doing. And it really decreases the overall time of recovery. Nothing is worse to me when I see someone that's been sick or not feeling well for 2 or 3 months. And they're like, why am I not better? We now have frustration. We now have anxiety. And now all of the symptoms are magnified because they don't understand why they don't feel better. As opposed to if I see them in a week or two, I can explain everything. We start them with the progressive. I get them into the other providers. And they often feel like, okay, I now have a plan. I know what to do. Here are the expectations. So that's my big thing. And the other thing is, for the concussion, you know, I hate almost just calling it concussion. I just want to call it traumatic impact, because it's never just a concussion. And for providers that work with concussion and patients who have suffered a concussion, it is such a complex injury because of the factors of the C-spine, because of the risk factors, because of the stress and anxiety of returning to work, returning to school, returning to sport. You really need to be sure you are managing every aspect of what can be affected in this injury, and you have to have a network of providers that you can work with. Yes, I started this program, and I started as just a PT, and the first thing I said when I started treating these patients, I said, I need a doctor and I need a psychologist, because I cannot do it by myself. It is a team approach, and you have to have a network of providers that are familiar with the diagnosis and how to manage this population to really be successful at this intervention. And not everybody can do that. We've already heard some from the ERs that the management is so vastly different. And unfortunately, that's a little bit of the culture around concussion, and we see it all the time, is different providers will say different things. They'll have different recommendations. So I'll have some people that send it to me within a couple days. I have some that say, oh, just wait 2 weeks. Just wait 2 weeks, straight to a headache, go back, and then you can gradually return. And then when they fail the return, nothing is more detrimental to that mental state at that point, because now they're like, why can't I go back? Why did I go head to head with the same kid, and he's back in school, he's back in sports, and now I'm still dealing with headaches? Well, maybe it was the whiplash. Maybe it's BPPV. Maybe it's these other things. And so it's really the sooner we can look at all of those aspects to get them back, the better they'll do. So that's kind of my soapbox. If you're going to treat it, you've got to have a network of people that you can use, whether it's physical medicine, rehab, absolutely psychology. If you need a neurologist, a lot of times neurologists don't really do much with it. They say, is it a brain injury? It's not. You know, kind of send you out. Sometimes they will do the medication management. ENTs can also be helpful to kind of rule up the vestibular part of it. Sometimes you need ortho, and we'll talk about this. I realized when I did this presentation, I was also working on an 8-hour presentation, so there's a lot of slides. Not going to get through them all today, but we'll kind of talk as we go, and I want to make sure I leave room for questions at the end. So kind of the biggest thing for mine is, how can physical therapy use to maximize outcomes? So, you know, really, in the last few years, I've been a therapist for 10 years. I've been treating concussion for almost 6, and I would say every day I learn something new. Every concussion within itself is unique, and I'll talk a little bit about the biomechanics of the injury, and that's just because of the nature of the impact of the injury. It's not necessarily the concussion, it's not necessarily the metabolism of the brain, it's not necessarily the energy demand, it's just the mechanism of injury that's really essentially unique in every impact that happens. So one of the things is, how can we manage? And some research has really become out to be supportive that says that physical therapy can play a role in this injury and recovery. And then what are some of the typical impairments we've seen? And then how does that affect a person's ability to work? We've talked about dizziness, we've talked about ocular motor dysfunction, but what does that look like when they return to work, when they return to school? What makes things difficult for them? And then also some common interventions that we do use, as well as some red flags that would need referral to alternative healthcare providers, whether it be our physiatry, whether it be psychology, whether it be neurology or ortho. And then some key co-moments when we talk about return to work activity protocol, and really making sure they're fully testing the vestibular system. The return to play, not that it's not important in adults with the return to work or return to activity, it's really important in those kids that we're not putting them as those contact type, you know, if your return to work is a professional athlete or, you know, coach, then yes, it's very important. But we really want to make sure when we put those kids back in the field where they can get that other injury, that they are cleared and they are recovered. Because we don't want to put them in a situation where they're going to get more symptoms, and then we kind of, again, fall back in that cycle and we end up with that vicious cycle of depression, anxiety, frustration. So we really want to try to avoid that the best we can. So again, it's symptom management. Dr. Melchiorre talked a little bit about how the symptom questionnaires don't correlate, and I don't disagree with him. But at the same time, we are very, very critical of what symptoms are reported. And so he was dead on when he said that other things can affect symptoms. So when people talk to me about their headache, and I'm like, and I do the initial eval, I'm like, I want you to tell me what your headache feels like right now. And I want you to remember what your headache feels like right now. Because more than often, it feels different than any other headache they've had before. And as we talk about it, I say, this is the headache that we're going to talk about in regards to this injury. I don't, you know, not that I don't care if you have a sinus headache, not that I don't care if you have other headaches. If you've had headaches before, you know what those feel like, you know what these like, and this is the headache we're going to talk about when we talk about recovery. I do have kids that come back to me with a sinus infection, and now all of a sudden they're dizzy, and I'm like, you've got congestion, this is what's causing it. So we're really critical of what those symptoms are, and as we go through the process, I don't have people fill out their symptom questionnaires every time. I ask them, how are you feeling today? If they're like, oh, I had a really bad day. Let's go through it. What caused your symptoms? What were you doing today that made you feel worse than yesterday? I've been doing this for 6 years, and I've changed my approach, and I change my approach all the time. And where I'm at right now is I need my patients to be an active participant in their recovery. It is not passive. You know, I don't just tell them what to do and tell them they're going to get better. They need to be active. They need to be aware of what their triggers are. They need to be responsible for how to manage this injury. And as they go through their day, I tell them, I can't be with you all day. I'm not going to tell you, hey, that really busy environment, you're not going to feel great and don't go in. They need to be aware as they walk into Target and it's back to school week and it's really busy and it's peak system, that's going to make them feel bad. Maybe they shouldn't go at that time. And why I found that's been successful is that they then understand why they have symptoms. They understand why they have their ups and downs. And nothing is better to me when a patient comes back and says, you know what, I had a really bad headache, but I think I did too much because I did this, this, and this. And that really empowers them to have control over the injury a little bit more and how they're feeling than if they just were like, I don't know why I feel so bad. And when I have kids in school, we talk about, is it math class? Is it reading? Are you doing a lot of looking up, looking down? You know, what is your head position like? What's your posture like? And that really helps them tease through the symptoms and say, okay, I understand why this works and why this doesn't and why I feel the way they do. And that helps decrease a lot of the anxiety around why do I feel so bad. Dr. Littaua talked a little bit about predictors of outcomes and overall prognosis. This is all I do all day long. I only treat concussion patients. And so what we found as we've been doing this and kind of tracking our progress over the last 3 years is that the earlier we see them, and you know, we're kind of looking at our numbers to see how, you know, the risk factors affect, all of the risk factors were identified before we started treating and really managing this injury early on. And I have a theory that because I see all kinds of patients with all kinds of different risk factors, that if we treat them early, we recognize the risk factors, we educate them on the risk factors, we say this is why you may feel this way, that those risk factors may not be as significant as we once thought they were. So again, it comes back to that education, but the early education that's important so that the patient just knows what's going on. Nothing's worse. I mean, when you're waiting on tests because you've been having chest pain, nothing is more stressful than having chest pain and not knowing what's causing it. So then you're going to have anxiety, and then what happens to your chest pain? it gets worse. All of a sudden you're like, oh my God, I'm getting worse, and nobody's telling me what's wrong with me. Why can't my blood results come back sooner? And it just feeds that cycle. And then all of a sudden you get headache and you get a dizzy because of your stress, and now you're anxious. And it feeds this cycle. Exact same thing that happens in concussion. So the more we can empower them and make them aware of what's going on, the better we can kind of manage all of those outside stressors. One of the things I say at Eval is the number one thing that predicts prolonged recovery is increased stress and anxiety. And I know these guys can definitely, and this is usually when I send them this way. If I have someone that I know has a huge anxiety disorder and they are just so worked up in the Eval and they're like, I just don't know what I'm gonna do. And I'm like, okay, we have the systems in place to help manage that. I have these two wonderful providers I'm gonna send you to. This is what we're gonna do in the meantime. And then all of a sudden it's like, oh, okay. Dr. Melchiorre always gets a ton more information than I do in the Eval, and he ends up identifying all these other things, and I'm like, which I think works, and this is why the team works. We come from very different approaches and how we manage it. You know, from a PT side of it, we're very, what's in front of us, what we're looking at, we look at the whole picture, but we just work with what we're dealing with, and we have very, like, objective things that we use to identify. Psychology comes from that different approach, always trying to tease it out, you know, figuring out what's going on. And then, you know, Dr. Littaua was wonderful, takes so much time with our patients, and they just come back feeling good. But then we sit down and talk and say, okay, this is what we're seeing, this is what we're seeing. And often they'll present differently to all of us, but then it puts us all on the same page, so then people aren't getting around any of us. So we know what's going on, and we have that communication, which is really important in the more complex cases that do have some other stress or anxiety or previous history around it, that we can work through that piece of it. But as I said, luckily nobody needs all, not everybody needs all of us. So early stages, again, just kind of really monitoring that. So we talked a little bit about rest. Dr. Littaua definitely talked about the importance of rest, and it is, but the question is always how much rest. So the recommendations for putting kids in a dark room, adults, anyone, for 7 days is no longer the recommendation post-concussion. There was a study that came out in 2014 that was done on kids in a journal of pediatrics that looked at 99 patients ages 11 to 22 that presented to the emergency room within 24 hours of their concussion. So they did a neurocognitive balance and symptom assessment of ED, and then they were randomized into an intervention group, which was a strict rest for 5 days. So couldn't do anything, they didn't go back to school, they didn't go back to their activities, limited electronics, and they kept a diary. The control group was usual care, kind of 1 to 2 days of rest, and then a gradual stepwise return to their previous activities. Well, they found the patients completed a diary using to record their physical and mental activity level, calculate their energy exertion, and then recorded their daily post-concussion symptoms. The neurocognitive and balance assessments were performed at days 3 and 10. And the finding was the group, intervention group had less attendance for school after school at days 2 and 5, which just makes sense because they were told to rest and not do anything. There was no clinically significant difference in their balance or neurocognitive assessments, but the intervention group reported more daily post-concussion symptoms over 10 days. And slower symptom resolution. And one of that factors is that they were isolated, they were depressed, they were bored. I mean, more than anything, they are bored. And so when you are bored, you put a teenager in a room and say you can't do anything, well, they're gonna go crazy. I would go crazy. I mean, and that's the thing, and that's what Dr. Melchiorre talked about. If people aren't used to staying still and not doing anything, they have a really hard time, because what do most of our kids do in downtime? They play video games. They play sports, you know, and now we're saying you can't do anything. Now they're isolated from their friends. Now they're out of school. Our type A kids, they're stressing because they're falling behind. They're missing things. They don't know how they're going to catch up. And so all of those increase those post-concussion symptom scales. So, you know, that depression, anxiety, frustration. Well, I always tell my patients, do you have a headache right now? And they're like, if you have to think about it, you don't have it. That is the number one thing. If you have to think about whether or not you have a symptom, you don't have it. I want to know about the symptoms that stop you doing what you're doing. And that's the biggest thing for them. Because if I sit here and think long enough, I'm going to give myself a headache. And I'm going to be like, yeah, I'm kind of dizzy. I'm on heels. Yeah, well, maybe I'm a little tired. And so it's really the symptoms that stop them doing that I want to know about, so that we can then intervene. So the take home is that strict rest, you know, rest is important, but we really need to be that proactive rest is kind of what we use here. And that's what's nice about seeing these patients early, so we can get them back there. Because a lot of times they leave the ERs, they leave their primary care, and they say, okay, just go back to work when you don't have a headache. Or a couple days, you just return. Well, then they go, and then they fall apart. And then again, oh my gosh, I feel terrible. The parents are like, well, they called me within 45 minutes because they had the worst headache ever. Or I just couldn't do anything at work, and my boss is like, what's wrong with you? And so it's giving them the guidance of how to return, I think, is just as important as allowing them to return and setting them up for success. I always tell my patients, I want you to be successful. I'm going to give you all the tools you can to be successful, and I'll help you through the process, but you have to use them. The tools are only as good as if you use them. So giving them those steps. So Dr. Littaua already kind of went through this. The biggest thing is that, you know, I really clinically, so, you know, not even to say about numbers, we started tracking our numbers 3 years ago in August of 2013. This past August, we our numbers totally, and this is just for PT, we've seen 1,070 concussion patients only, and our numbers have grown significantly since then. So this month alone, we're going to see 50 new concussion patients that are coming through our doors for physical therapy. And what we found is that, I don't know that age is always the issue as so much, but we do know they're more vulnerable, but I think it's the amount of stress that that person experiences and that they're going through that can directly affect that recovery process. So this is why, you know, we really get the other tools in place, you know, and I would say the stress not only from kids in school, but the stress from kids, from adults returning to work. My adults are much harder to shut down than my kids because of all the other responsibilities they have. I had one 2 years ago. I was a terrible patient. Terrible. I had a six-month-old and a three-year-old, and I was moving. I did not shut anything down. And knowing as much as I know, but I had the education to know what I was experiencing and why I was experiencing it. It was directly my own fault. So I didn't have the anxiety over why I had my symptoms. I knew what they were coming from. So, you know, I think it's knowing what you can do. If I do anything with the schools, it's to get teachers to stop putting zeros while these kids are recovering and making up work. That is the number one thing. I can't tell you how many kids come back to me and say, but I have a zero where that is. My grades are, and I'm like, it will go away. It will get better. You will be allowed to make up the work you need to make up. And that's one of the other parts we're really trying to work with the schools to help them recognize what are the contributions to the symptoms that they're doing to these kids and how can they better manage the transition back. So it's that really it's that stress. The most we can stress, minimize the stress, the better it is. Dizziness, you know, Dr. Littaua worked at, this has been the one that's been found to be the predictor of the prolonged recovery. So it was found in a study, and I'll talk about it in a minute, but dizziness at the time of injury, they were found 7 times more likely to have that greater than 21-day recovery period. And that involved directly that vestibular system, visual motion space discomfort, things like that, that we can effectively treat in therapy. So the prognosis, we've already talked about this, you know, and this is the research we are talking about. So the old research was 80% of all concussions recover within 21 days. That research was done by the creators of Impact out of Pittsburgh, who do a fantastic job with our research. However, that recovery time was only based on impact testing and symptom reporting alone, nothing else. So what they found is that their new research, the same exact group, did a new study in 2016 that said that when you do the recommended comprehensive approach, which is looking at the neck, looking at the vestibular oculomotor system, incorporating psychology, having physical medicine, when you're looking at the injury as a total, then concussion assessment recovery time for sports-related concussion, this is approximately 3 to 4 weeks, which was common, which is longer than the commonly reported 7 to 14 days. They also recommend the early intervention model, and some of the research that we've done ourselves have found that those that we saw within 2 weeks from injury, so within 14 days and we initiated therapy, got better on average at 26 days as compared to the group that we saw outside of that 14-day window, and they took on average 68 days to get better. So it really does make a difference. And so I'm a big proponent of early intervention. It just makes everyone's job so much easier. And it really gets these people back sooner, and they can just move on with their lives, and that's nothing better than someone can put the injury behind them as opposed to dealing with it for 6, 8, 9 years, months to 1 year. Now, 9 years, it's a whole other level. So that was kind of the biggest thing with that one. Dr. Melchiorre talked a little bit about kind of Dr. Letty's research. I'm going to talk a little bit about Dr. Collins' research, who is in neuropsychology, again, this group out of Pittsburgh. And this is what's really important when we look at how do we break down the injury. So again, you know, we found that some of the researchers, they did a study. This is an article by Contos et al. That was published in 2013 and essentially described a new method for conceptualizing treatment. And again, this is sports-related concussion, but definitely can be used across the spectrum. And it was using their clinical experience. These guys see over 18,000 concussions a year. This is all they do. They treat the NFL, they treat the NHL, they treat, you know, NASCAR. They're all of the top people that you're seeing are getting concussion recoveries. These are the guys that are doing the treatment. So they're really kind of on that front edge leading what's going on.
They looked at the current literature of sport-related concussion and they combined it with their clinical experience, and they developed an approach to manage it using these clinical trajectories and targeted treatments. It is effective, but I think you take it with a grain of salt. The biggest thing I want to be take home is that there's different trajectories and nobody ever falls in just one trajectory. They all overlap, and you need to be able to, as a clinician, as someone who's working this injury, you need to be able to identify all of those aspects, how they affect the recovery, and then who do you need to get them to help manage that. Because again, I cannot stress it enough, I cannot do this by myself. There is no chance. I need my network of providers that I work with. I work with these guys. I have some sports medicine docs I work with. We have ENTs. Dr. Littaua has a list of neuro-ophthalmology, optometry, you know, they have psychiatry. So you need to have all of those people available to you to really be able to effectively manage the entire approach. So, you know, concussion presentation is highly variable. I am not kidding when I learn something new every day. I have two evals waiting for me when I go back to the clinic. I guarantee I'm gonna see something different. You know, it's just every one of them is unique. But they're nice, for me, you know, 10 years out, it's like a little puzzle. Every time I do this, it's like a little puzzle. I gotta figure out something a little bit different. How are you different? What's your trigger? How do I fix this? You know, and it really keeps it interesting and it keeps it from getting boring, which is nice. There have been other studies, again, we talked about Letty and Buffalo, and they looked at breaking down the concussion by symptom report alone, which Dr. Melchiorre talked about, and then focusing on difference between the physiologic concussion and the vestibular cervical counterpoints. So this is one thing that this group left out, was that physiologic component, the ability to tolerate exercise. I would even put some of that sleep in that physiologic component. And so I would add one more trajectory to this bucket, and so you can add, you have to make sure you address that. But they did found that you couldn't differentiate by symptom report alone, and that's really important. Oh, geez. I'm hitting weird things. You can't differentiate just about what someone tells you. You have to look at the clinical picture, and that can be challenging with concussion because there's no one test. I mean, you tear your ACL, you do the MRI, there's the tear, we know what we're gonna do, let's put him back, we do the surgery, we get him back. Well, concussion, it doesn't show up. We have to look at the clinical presentation. We not only have to take the history and mechanism of injury, we also have to take their clinical symptom reporting, and then what do we see clinically? And we'll talk a little about what I do on my exam. Dr. Melchiorre does some testing. Dr. Littaua, we have an advantage, has a PT background, so she does evaluate the vestibular system a little bit in her testing. She does her balance, we do strength. But a lot of these impairments, you know, I have so many people that say, well, they did a neuro exam. Thankfully, nothing shows up on the neuro exam because that's not how this injury presents. So, you know, I do a much more detailed differential diagnosis evaluation that looks at these symptoms and these impairments in a little bit of a different way that kind of helps me identify which one is contributing the most. So this is a nice way that kind of breaks down what they may be reporting and then how do they fit in each category. So, you know, when they typically say, when we think it's more related to the vestibular system, they have some unstable vision, they feel like they have difficulty with balance and motion, they just don't like moving in crowded environments, quick head turns tend to bother them. If they're running or trying to move fast, that tends to be, you know, bending over to pick up, I rolled over and I started spinning. Those are your clear markers of the vestibular impairments. Ocular, oftentimes it's trouble with visual tasks, tracking motion, so a lot of times they have headaches with reading, or they feel like the words are jumping when they're trying to read, or things are bouncing around, doing a lot of work on the computer, you know, ocular fatigue is a big one, and we look at that one. The cognitive fatigue is, you know, trouble with extended or intricate mental tasks. They wake up feeling great, you know, they're good, they slept well, they feel pretty good, they go to school. Let's say they have calculus first. Woof! By about 9 o'clock, they're done. But not only do we have to think of that, was that just your concentration? Or are you having a hard time looking down and looking up at the board? Is it on a whiteboard? Are you reading word problems? Is it just the formulas that you're trying to track across the page? How many decimal points are you counting out that you have to look across? So it's never just kind of one thing. You have to be able to tease it out and make sure you look at all the different things that could be contributing to those impairments at that time. Migraine, you know, I'll talk about in a minute about the role of post-traumatic migraine, so people that now have a new onset of migraines related to the concussion and their outcomes, as those that have a history of migraines. We do know that a history of migraines can definitely affect recovery after concussion. One of the things that this group boasts, if they have a history of migraines, you need to, and then we'll talk about the anxiety and mood too, you need to get these guys exercising sooner rather than later, because both of those, exercise has been beneficial to help management of migraine and anxiety and mood. So if you take them out of their normal routine of exercise, if you have someone who likes to work out a lot, They use that as their stress relief. They use it to help manage their migraines. Well, now they have a concussion, and now I say you can't do anything. All of that's going to build back up, then contribute to their symptoms and make it worse. So these are my guys that I start exercising sooner rather than later. When we talk about exertion affecting recovery, it's heavy exertion. They found that mild to moderate low intensity exercise has been beneficial even in the early stages after concussion. So we do it in a very monitored fashion as we recommend that they return. And then cervical. So, you know, if they're reporting any stress or pattern of pressure, so this one, they just talked about stress or pressure on the neck spine. I added the pattern of headache and waking up with the headache. I can't tell you how many kids tell me they don't have any neck pain. I'm like, does your neck hurt? No. All right, turn your head side to side. Does that hurt?
No.
Can you go any further?
Maybe.
You know, and then I start poking. Well, all of a sudden that's like, ow, that really, really hurts. And we find that they don't necessarily know they have neck pain. A lot of times the neck just feels stiff or tight, but they don't know how to verbalize that to you. My adults are pretty good at telling me when they have neck pain. They can identify that right off the bat. And so we definitely have to work through that piece of it. The nice thing, you know, if you do have this pattern, I actually find it almost impossible to get a concussion based on the mechanism of injury without doing some kind of dysfunction to that upper cervical spine. If I have a patient that wakes up with a headache and they've been sleeping well, it's not that they're having disrupted sleep, I'm thinking neck. If they just say, you know, my headache is like, it hurts here and it hurts here and it goes all the way down and I can see their SCMs firing from across the room, then I'm thinking neck. I often tell my patients, you're going to have two different headaches. You're going to have a pressure-based headache that typically feels as you start doing more activity as the day goes on. That's your concussion, more than likely. It's that pressure-building headache. The headache that kind of is there all the time, maybe as your posture's here, if I have you sit up and I have you do a chin tuck, getting better posture, your headache goes down, that's the headache coming from your neck. We have to treat both of those as we go on, and you're going to see how different things manifest. Again, it's really empowering the patient to be aware of what their symptoms are, but with a fine line of not making them hyper aware of what their symptoms are. I had a woman the other day that came in. She's very complicated, has the history of anxiety, fibromyalgia, just multiple things going on, has a ton of visual motion sensitivity, has some neck issues, has, you know, vestibular ocular stuff, but then also had VPPV on top of it, so the positional vertigo based on the mechanism of injury. So I corrected her PPPV, and I was like, well, how are you feeling? She's like, oh, I'd like to tell you good, but I still feel horrible. And I'm like, okay, let's sit down. Let's talk about why you feel horrible. Has your spinning gotten better? Oh, yeah, my spinning is better, but I still have this dizziness. Okay, check. I've treated that part, but now I've got to move on to the next section. So it's making them realize that there are improvements being seen. I understand they don't feel good sitting in front of me, but let's look at what you first came and told me. I have another guy that he was telling me he was 9s and 10s, and he still comes in, he's like, oh my gosh, I just feel terrible. What's your headache at? 3. Okay, that's a win. You were a 9, now you're at a 3, and now it's not constant, and it's making them aware that they're making progress, even though they may not always see it. And then they walk out and they say, okay, I do feel better. So it's really, again, going back to the education, having them be an active participant in their recovery so they're not just being told what to do. And they know what's going to be, they can be responsible for it. So then I talked about physiological things. So again, we're going to talk quickly about the physical therapy management. So we focus on symptom reporting, but then targeting intervention. So we do a lot of work on the vestibular ocular motor system and the cervical spine. When I started this program 3 years ago, at 4 years ago now, at Sheltering Arms, I didn't do much with the spine. I was a pediatric therapist. I did acute care, the spine scared the heck out of me, and I was like, I want nothing to do with this. But I really liked concussion, and I really liked the dizziness, and I felt like I was getting better. So if you didn't tell me you had neck pain, I'm not touching your neck. As I started treating more and more patients, and we got more and more involved, I'm like, you know what, I think I can get these headaches better faster. I'm missing something. And we decided to say, that cervical spine is an equal and active contributor to their symptoms at the time of injury. And we've taken a much closer look at what the neck is doing. And the nice thing about it is, one, you can tell them it's not your brain, you know, and that always feels better, that your headaches are coming from something other than your brain. You're not going to have brain damage. But then when they are super symptomatic, doing some general manual therapy, doing some, you know, muscle release. Who doesn't enjoy a massage? They don't always enjoy my massage because I find the trigger points and I stick at them. But it makes you feel better. And they typically walk out saying, wow, you know what? My neck does feel better. My headache is less. And that's nothing better than to send someone out feeling better than they came in, as opposed to where I sometimes send them out feeling worse. But so that's the thing. The hard thing with the vestibular therapy is to talk about, I go after their symptoms. The whole point of the vestibular therapy is I find out what provokes their symptoms, I make them do it, and I make them keep doing it at a threshold, of course, it sounds totally cruel, until it doesn't bother them as much. And so it's a little bit of a different mechanism. So if I have a patient that's just had a really bad day, I know they're not going to tolerate, they've been in school all day, they've been at work, and they're just like, I have an awful headache, I'm going to start with the neck first. I'm going to work there and then give them a little bit of feel good, let them have some relief, and then torture them in another way. So that's the thing. The other thing is, you know, we do the vestibular, and you know, physical therapists are really uniquely qualified. I mean, I think physical therapists doing vestibular therapy, not a new thing. They've been doing it for years. Physical therapists doing cervical injury impairment, not a new thing. We specialize in exercise-based tasks. What the difference is that we recognize that these are impairments related to concussion and we can now treat them. And the physical therapists, if you get to the right therapists that know what to look for, we can really blend these well and we can really work to identify them. I have a team of now we're up to 8 therapists in sheltering arms that really only, there's 4 of us that only treat concussion. And so really specific in how we do it. We look at it the same way. It's a very consistent product. But they are just as excited about their research as I am. I'm kind of a nerd when it comes to it. And they get just excited and they want to help these people get better. So that's really, you know, not everybody knows what to do. But when you find the person that does, it makes a world of difference. So I got my 10 minutes warning. So evidence-based practice, there's been some recent systematic review of the literature. To look at just vestibular rehabilitation, can that be effective? And right now, the optimal prescription, you know, it's weak, it's limited. However, the studies that have been put out there do show promise in being able to help them. So almost all the studies have shown that with vestibular therapy, and if they're having vestibular impairments, they get better. Some more looked at, you know, athletes with these issues have longer recovery time. So when we screen them for these, vestibular and vision therapists were applying specific rehabilitation and interventions to enhance this recovery process, and then that really indicates that these can really be helpful. The other thing is that's good to know is that we then incorporate them back into the return to play, return to work. So knowing what their impairments are, we can kind of capture what may be problematic for them when they return and help to modify those specific areas. And then the combination of cervical and vestibular rehabilitation, in this study, they combined the control group just had postural ed, range of motion, some cognitive physical rest until asymptomatic, then they did return to play. The intervention group had cervical spine and vestibular rehab, and they were almost 4 times more likely to be medically cleared by 8 weeks. So again, really important that the therapy does help. This was a group of 12 to 30. They had symptoms defined as greater than 10 days from injury, and they started just with 1 times a week therapy with PT. And then their cervical interventions were manual therapy, thoracic spine to cervical, and mobilizations. And then therapy exercise consisting of the retraining exercises and then some vestibular exercises as well. So that combination has really been found to be the most successful, and I would agree that I see the same thing in my clinical practice. So common impairments, we've talked a little bit about, we'll kind of run through this. I want to make sure you guys know what it looks like when they go back. So, you know, some things to refer for red flags. If I have someone that has visual field cuts, I'm just seeing really odd eye movements, significant memory loss that's persistent, one-sided weakness, seizures, all of that, I'm getting them to a neurologist if they hadn't already been there. I often work with these are all definitely people I'm sending to PM&R as well, but I'm definitely getting them to neurology for that as part. If for ENT, if they're having one-sided hearing loss or significant ringing or oral symptoms, I just want to make sure the integrity of that vestibular system is intact. If it's just BPV, I'll correct that. I don't feel like they need to go to the ENT for that. Ortho, I send them to when the neck is pretty severe, they're having numbness or tingling down one side, I'm concerned that a disc is involved. I actually just sent one back up for some upper cervical spine stability imaging testing because they were testing positive and were showing some kind of red flags that I was concerned for some upper cervical spine instability before I did anything to their neck. So those kinds of things that are pretty typical as a therapist should be able to recognize and refer on. And then anytime I have a patient that comes in that's telling me they're not sleeping or they're having migraines, difficulty with accommodations, or I think they're just going to be more complicated, I'm getting them to Dr. Littaua. And I'm getting them as fast as I can. Because the sleep, if you are not sleeping, nobody's going to feel better. And that's the end of the game. Not one of my patients is going to get better if you're not sleeping at night. So we need to figure out how can we get you sleeping through the night. I had a patient present to me yesterday. He got cleared from his concussion in June. And this goes to what Dr. Melchiorre's point was. Symptom-free for 3 months, had been going back to school, had finished up his school last year, no problem, had been playing baseball. He started school again, and all of a sudden he started not being able to sleep. So he would fall asleep, but he couldn't stay asleep. And now all of a sudden he has headaches and dizziness. So the primary care, the pediatrician sent him back to me and said, post-concussion syndrome. And I said, I don't think so. Because one, all of his symptoms are different now than they were with the original injury. And so I talked to the doctor, I said, you know, maybe he has an onset of migraines now that he didn't have before, his symptoms are differently, but this is not the original concussion. Something else is going on and we need to figure out why he's not sleeping. He never had sleep difficulties initially, there was no new life stresses, nothing really that had changed in this kid's life that I was trying to figure out. But that's really important because the primary care just said, okay, I'm gonna send him to sheltering arms, they know what they're doing, it's post-concussion. So I asked the kid, I said, do you think this is your concussion? And he was like, no, I really don't. But what effect does that have that now he says, well, it's my concussion is back. It's not. Once they're recovered and we clinically have recovered them, it typically won't come back unless there's a new mechanism of injury. And so that was really important that you need to be able to differentiate. I think we need to get this kid to another provider to figure out what really is going on and not just call it the concussion. So, you know, we do testing and rehab. So the return to play essentially is testing all those symptoms, making sure we're not causing any symptoms when they go back to play. So a lot of dynamic stuff. Up and down, changing positions, sprinting, fast-paced. I take my adults through it too. They do an agility ladder, depending on what they're going back to. So I really want to make sure that, you know, I've had people golf. I've had people, you know, do anything. If these are things they want to get back to, let's try it. I have a very active outdoorsman who is a hunter. And so I am putting him on all kinds of things that simulate him on a boat, that, you know, would simulate him climbing in a tree stand, you know, to see what he feels like. I've been known to stand on a chair and act as a volleyball net. To see if people can spike over me. And because I want to make sure that when they go back out there, that they feel good. I'm also known to have my football players tackle dummies in the gym. I'm also known to hit them with bolsters as they run through cones. Because I want to make sure that they're okay. I make my soccer players roll and dive. I make them do it with their eyes open and their eyes closed. Because we need to make sure that those systems can take those impacts. And we need to be aggressive when they go back. Because there's not necessarily going to be someone out there that's going to do it for them. So really kind of being, you know, taking a really detailed history, mechanism of injury really becomes important because then that kind of pulls in the other symptoms. You know, is it cervical, is it, you know, positional vertigo, things like that. I just realized I talked way too long, I'm sorry. We've gone through this already. I can stop here. The rest just kind of goes through detailed what therapy looks at. So, you know, again, some of my cervical spine interventions. The biggest thing I want you to know is we can treat it. So I want to open it up real quick for questions, if there are any.